Well, I think there are many things happening in that field. We were just commenting about the incremental rise of energy consumption, and I think that's something that we cannot stop. Thanks God, more and more people is having more purchasing power, and that means that people is buying more gadgets and more devices, and that means more energy consumption. So that's something that we cannot stop, and I wonder if the individual really has something to say in that sense. I believe there is a combination of elements that we have to take into account. For instance, we should strive for maximizing energy efficiency of devices, and we know that for many product categories, there's still a lot of room for improvement. In the area of televisions, for instance, that already happened by changing technologies. We went from CRTs to LCD televisions, and a big improvement has been achieved there. But what we see also is that although new technologies like LCD are much more efficient than CRT, we are aiming for much bigger screens, so we are undercompensating. I think that the future of energy is very much about the way we are going to produce energy and how we are going to manage the consumption of this energy. Later on, there's going to be a presentation about that, but I would like to give an example about a company, for instance, like Current. We see that the future of energy production is about decentralized energy production. And we see also that it looks like large companies are not going to be the ones producing energy and selling to you. It's going to be more communities and neighborhoods producing their own energy, doing an efficient use of this energy by smart systems, and then reselling what is left to the grid. So that's more or less how I see the future of energy.
So you feel that in the world of standardization, we will need to develop a very new method of standardization and a new method of applying them so that you can introduce your current into the system. How would you suggest we could deal with the green side to it? How do you know that you will be buying green electricity and not dirty electricity?
Right. Well, I don't really have an answer for that. But I will say that probably in a near future, I don't think it's going to be such a thing like green energy or dirty energy. Most energy is going to be coming from clean sources. Either it's going to be solar, it's going to be wind power, it's going to be, you name it. There are many options out there. It's clear that the future of the so-called dirty energy is pretty short. It's an announced death, probably. So I will expect that in some years' time, we won't think about that, and we will all consume clean energy. But we can also look at the consumer perspectives, because if you talk about the standards, we're talking about labels before. And my experience, I also been working in the field of sustainable product designs, and in general, labels do not work. Consumers do not understand what the labels mean. There are only a few examples of labels that really work, and that would be, for instance, the ones related to energy, when we talk about white goods like fridges or washing machines. And it's not so much that the consumer understands what is the environmental impact of the machine, but what the label is saying is how much money at the end of the day they are going to save. If I buy a device that is more energy efficient, it's going to be much economically interesting for me. So I will link standards, I will link labels to consumer convenience, what it is that the consumer is looking for. In general, consumers are not interested in green. Green per se does not sell. Green only sells when it's linked to consumer convenience. How is this making my life easier? How is this improving my quality of life?
Very interesting. The subsidiary question to the Lyft conference, if you had the equivalent sum of the carbon that we are generating during the Lyft conference, what would you do with that sum?
Well, many things, probably. There are many options, but I like the proposition that we heard this morning. I'm a big fan of the 100 laptop, the One Laptop Per Child Foundation, and I think that would be a great idea if that money could be invested buying computers, buying laptops for these kids in developing countries, not so much for the fact of them having a laptop, but this is really an empowering tool that opens to a new world, and it's helping us to be connected. So if it's not the $100 laptop, I will spend it on something that empowers the end user.
Oriol Pasquale, thank you.
Thank you very much.